Okay, so which are the four morphologic diagnoses of paratuberculosis, mycobacterial paratuberculosis infections in cattle and sheep? If you see a slide like this, there are four morphologic diagnoses. Not one, not two, not three, four. What's missing in this slide? What's missing? Five. So emaciation first, which is the most difficult to detect. Second, granulomatous lymphadenitis. Third, of course, there is granulomatous enterocolitis. And the fourth is granulomatous lymphadenitis. Remember, enterocolitis, lymphadenitis, lymphadenitis, emaciation, serodactyl. Generally, you don't see always lymphadenitis and you don't see always emaciation, serodactyl. But in an ideal pathology world, an emaciated cattle due to paratuberculosis that is for differential diagnosis. Sheep the same, the only difference is that sheep don't show much clinical signs, cattle, a few bacteria can induce a lot of clinical signs. And interestingly, in deer, and then we cut it short, the bacteria can go from the lymph node to the liver, from the lymph node from the liver, the lymphatics are connected between liver and lungs. They can go to the bronchial lymph node. So in affected deer, which is also rather resilient, you can even see lymphadenitis from the ascending infection. Pretty incredible. It's a devastating disease. When you see a clinical sign in the cattle, the whole farm has it. It's the tip of the iceberg. It's very little bacteria, it's very little. I could talk much longer, but we need to go further. And here we are, classic. You cannot stretch this rugae, this fold. This thickening lymph node can be virusly affected. This one is very severely affected. This one is much less, but the microbacteria will be here. That's the lesion in cattle. You see mild changes, but you can see that the lymphatics are involved. And here it is, a villus in cross section, lots of macrophages. So, ischiocytic enterocolitis, granulomatous in the United States. So in Europe, you need to see a granulomatous. In the United States, everything is macrophages, can be called histiocytic and granulomatous. Etymology doesn't fit because a granuloma is a granule, but in the United States, by extension, it's called granulomatous. And you can see giant cells, of course, lymphocytes, plasma cells, some classic bovine neutrophils, and then the lymphangitis, spare lymphangitis, intraluminal lymphangitis, granulomatous, and then another giant cell, so these droplets, you can speculate that could be bacteria or bacteria that's been digested, and then here we are. Don't expect all the time such a severe, that's a prominent presence of microbacteria, because often there are just a few in a section, and cattle can have just a lymphoplasmacytic infiltration, a few bacteria and they have dramatic clinical signs. Remember cattle before they need to be generally exposed before 6 months of age to develop the severe clinical form. If they get exposed after 6 months of age, then apparently they seem to be more resistant. This condition has been identified in the mid-80s by Dr. Cohen from New York State. In fact, in 1993 he told me about this condition, and guess what? A few months later we saw it on the literature. And then when I moved to Gibraltar Center in 1999, this is one of the first cases I observed. This is this condition doesn't have etiology. It's not fungus, as some people speculated. It's not Clostridium, because several of these cases are not associated with Clostridium isolation identification. Jejunal hemorrhagic syndrome often affects very healthy and well-conditioned cattle, and has got several presentations. That's the classic, with a big hematoma within the lumen of the jejunum. Some people were able to do surgery on this animal and save them. In there, you can find an ulcer or ruptured blood vessel. Sometimes you don't see much near the hematoma, or sometimes it's very difficult to find the area of ulcer ulceration. And sometimes the hematoma goes even in the submucosa. So there are two, three different type of presentations. Volvulus, it happens. Doesn't happen frequently like in horses, but what will happen? Look at the cecal dilatation. The whole mesenteric root has been involved. And great picture from my mentor, Professor Giovanni Mandelli, which just came back from his training in Hanover in 1954. And great pathologist. And that's when TB was rampant all over Europe, especially in every part of Italy. By the way, apparently it's not being eradicated there. And here there is the ulcerative form in the intestine, so granuloma that then are associated with ulceration. And look at the beauty of this collateral that has got so many years. The color were amazing. Mind-boggling bodies. So, enteric form is there, you don't see it much. We see it in carnivore occasion, especially in mesenteric. Channel island reeds, Jerseys and Guernseys, highly producer, but they got a genetic colony fat necrosis. This poor animal developed fat necrosis in the spiral colon, and when they develop near the rectum, they get constriction, and then they really develop colic, and they need to be euthanized, unfortunately. Fat necrosis, there are many causes in cattle, in any location. The ketotic fat necrosis, traumatic fat necrosis, idiopathic, genetically related, also even some virus infection can be associated with fat necrosis. So there are many types of fat necrosis. Dose eruption, be gentle with cattle, like in horses, rectal examination, the roof of the caudal intestine stretches, and stretching is the locus minoris, the resistance is the site where you can have a rupture. This is longitudinal. So be always gentle with your animals. Female exploring are much better than male exploring. I'm borrowing this from one of my goat cases. That's Monietia or Monietia. There are tapeworms of ruminants. There is Monietia spansa, Monietia benedeni. And they all have, like all herbivores, like rhabdocephalus horses, they got an intermediate host, which is a mite, the oripathic mite. They go on the grass. The herbivores eat the grass with the infected mite, and they get infestation. And you remember that in the Carlos case I showed you before? This case from the same farm. So tapeworm in ruminants can be common in farms where not being treated. And guess how do you call this exudate? We mentioned parasites are characterized by catarrh. So that's clearly catarrh. Other parasites, Bryson spongiates, and any kind of spongiate you can find in the in a microscope, in the gut of cattle. You can find even Gunostomum gunocephalus, which is the ansiosoma like nematode of cattle, quite a few. And that's a bison, the same bison that had the ostertagia, the very thick mucosa in the abomasum. This animal that also rather prominent catarrhal nephritis plus anemia due to the curious discord. Look at how many parasites. Look at how anemic this poor animal is. There is a microplastic nephritis with lymphocytes and plasma cells. And here we are, that's tricuris, which is almost intraepithelial. Look at this. These are stretched epithelial cells, maybe that's a mesenchymal cell, so the channels are really at the tip of the mucosa. And here we have lymphocyte plasma cells and neutrophils. And the glands are hyperplastic for sure. Oh, and in case of parasitic infestation, like this cow examined a couple of years ago at Louisiana State University, there is severe edema and lymphoedema. And these lymphoedema are big because there is edema, and there is lymphoedema hyperplasia, and lymphocytes and plasma cells and some neutrophils. So, you know this stuff, it's very simple. Coccidia, Aemalia bovis, in any age, but generally in adults is not so pathogenic, but in shedding, and Aemalia suebi, mainly calves, red diarrhea of calves. And Cryptosporidium, which can be, adults generally are not, they're not dying from Cryptosporidiosis like calves, but they can shed it, maintain it into the environment, and we mentioned the classic outbreak in penicillins, which upset the rotation for extended Cryptosporidium in this EM. I wish I could acknowledge the person that provided me this one many years ago, and I wish I would remember the site where I was able to obtain my apologies. Esophagostomy. We see quite a bit of this condition, esophagostomiasis in the small intestine, large intestinal cattle, but we see the mature form, the chronic form, where the parasites are totally obliterated by granuloma and calcification. Classic serosal lesion, sometimes even mucosal, incidental finding, it indicates that that form, that environment had some parasitic action. And then alimentary lymphoma, that's the same graph I showed you before. Lymphadenopathy with infiltration, and then mucosa that is very thick, sometimes thymic involvement, possibly non-infectious form. And then, since we are talking about the GI, we cannot ignore the fact that you can have perforations and septic peritonitis. So we need to consider the peritoneum as well. And since we consider the peritoneum, also some serosatic fat with emaciation again. And then we had this case in 1994 at Cornell University, and this animal developed intestinal adenocarcinoma. Look at this poor syncope. Lymphoma and carcinoma. Lymphoma can have this appearance, but in the dark you can differentiate their nature, because lymphoma is soft unless you use the stroma to resist the tissue. So the lymphoma can be tricky, but generally carcinoma is sclerosis because it uses the proliferation out of desmoplasia. So we think the origin was GI. We also checked the uterus just case was not a metastatic uterine carcinoma. So all cattle develop tumors like that, pancreas, uterus, and other sites, so we rule out that as well. And that's a close-up, it's using metastatic cirrhosis. Differential diagnosis, mesothelioma, but I don't remember seeing one in a cow. I saw it in horses, other animals, in mice, in dogs, but not in cattle. And carcinomatosis, interestingly, these lumps, these metastases, are away from the blood vessel. So probably they just use the latest turn of the capillaries to see into the receptor. So interesting. They are always in these areas of the tonic over here. So we would expect to see something here, you know, along the blood vessel. Interesting. Oh, abomasal displacement as a complication as thrombosis of the blood vessels, abdominal blood vessels. So this could be a sepsis complication, but also abomasal volumes. That's a adolescent thrombus. Feature of thrombosis. First of all, you need to see something that looks like a thrombus. And so that's clotting, that's a thrombus, because the thrombus is pale, is dry, it's friable, but not as gelatinous as the clot. And also tend to be attached to the endothelium. So all these features make a thrombus a real thrombus. But the microscope things can be a little bit more difficult, but that's for the gross examination of thrombus. A thrombus can be sterile or septic, can be acute, the acute or subacute, like in this case, or can be organized. And then we see in certain species, like sheep, especially in the pulmonary artery, or in occasionally small animals, and also in goats, and in cattle, we see degeneration and rupture of some abdominal blood vessels, including the ruminant artery, ciliary mesenteric artery. And my mentor John Keane in Cornell saw many cases on a certain site of Cayuga Lake. And then eventually some other students publish it. But that's what we see, long time ago. And you can see that there is a rumen here, and this is the ruminant artery, big hematoma. And I took these pictures in Cornell a few months later. You can see this was an abdominal cavity. Arterial blood, fresh, bright. She bled out. So that location. Complications, severe dehydration, case of diarrhea, that occurs very fast. This is not choranoplasty due to infectious disease is just cold cataract. You keep them in the cooler, close to zero, they get to cloud up. And again, for the third, fourth time, emaciation in case of severe chronic diarrhea, especially with salmonella or other or parasitic diseases, serous atrophy of the bone marrow, and osteopenia. And why I'm putting a section of a neuron with BSC? Here we are in England, 1992, new market, slice collection. Never seen such a beautiful neuron with so much fertilization. That's water, by the way. So, Bright disease, Mantel disease, low exposure for the cephalopathy. And I just put this with immunohistochemistry. That's a scrape, by the way. Detection of prime, modified proteins. Because if you perform immunohistochemistry in ESA cattle or scrapie sheep in the GI, in the ganglia, you can find the antigen. So the antigen is not only in the brain, in the lymphoid tissue near the eyelid, but it's also in the gut. So contamination of the meat with this prime occur also in this. So it's a stretch, but I want to just be concluding my presentation. And that's Sardinia, one of my favorite regions on the planet, where I try to go every year to see if there is a meeting. If anybody's interested, there is still time to join the secret Italian Society of Veterinary Sciences, and is in Olbia this time. Join us with Robert De Vino and George Clooney at the same budget. The 4 days, the meeting cost $180 or $200. Euros, €400, food included, you can do that. And then you want to go to the meeting, go to the meeting, you want to go to the meeting, because this is a gorgeous Sardinia, amazing. So the hand means, any question, raise your hand, and I will be even, but I will work another time. That ends the formal presentation. We have a little follow-up. But if you have got any question, that's the moment to ask the questions. Or just be silent. Well, if not, thank you for being so alert for a long time. Thank you for talking much less than several other Mediterraneans on meeting. And it was lovely to be here. And great to see you.